thank you, first of all, to the Chamber for organizing this event today. On October 19, you will have the opportunity to choose your area's representative to Ottawa. I've had the honor of serving as your Member of Parliament since 2006. Under the leadership of our Prime Minister, Canada has led the world in employment and GDP growth. Our lower tax plan is working. Reduced business taxes have created opportunities to invest and create more jobs. Reduced income taxes and GST leave more money in the hands of Canadians to invest in the needs of their families. Our budget has returned to surplus a year ahead of schedule during the toughest economic time since the Great Depression. Rather than balance budgets by slashing $25 billion from transfers to provinces, Prime Minister Harper chose strategic and disciplined spending. I was proud to support local infrastructure investment that helped to build the Breslau Community Center and improve the Breslau Airport. Upgrade Floridale Road, Samuel Street, Snyder Avenue, Line 86, Northfield Drive, and Catherine Street, and expand Highway 8 access to 8 lanes across the Grand River, and also to begin construction on the LRT. These projects created hundreds of local jobs in the short term, and they improve our crucial infrastructure in the long term. Small business is the engine of our economy, and by reducing taxes, we are looking to them to create jobs and opportunity for even more Canadians. Friends, we don't need higher taxes, and we don't need more debt. On October 19, we'll improve leadership for a strong economy. On October 19, I need your support to help keep Canada strong. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bob Jonkman, your candidate for the Green Party. I live in Elmira. I've lived in Elmira for 15 years. It's really nice to be able to do a debate like this from the comfort of home. I thought when I initially got into the Green Party and to run for this election, that I would focus on representation, proportional representation specifically. But I'm finding, as I've been speaking to people, that issues about poverty and the economy and, yes, lack of representation from the current government are the overwhelming concerns of the people out there. So my intent is to be able to provide that. I find that the Green Party's policies are actually aligned with that, to ensure that people are well represented in Parliament, that decorum is restored to Parliament, and that jobs and economy and healthcare are all taken care of by people. The Green Party has a number of good plans to achieve that. I hope to be able to effect that for you if I'm elected as a representative.
Thank you, Bob.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to the KW Greater Chamber of Commerce for inviting me out today. Thank you to our moderator as well, Glenn Peltier from 570 News. Now, I'm James Villeneuve, your NDP candidate for October 19. I'm a certified sheet metal worker. I live in the riding in the Kitchener area. I've served as an officer of my local for 16 years. I'm in my second term as their president. I also serve as a trustee on our health and welfare pension trust fund. Election after election, members have put their faith in me to make sure that they have good benefits, also ensuring that they will have a good pension when they retire. I ran provincially last year and did have a strong showing of 20% of the vote. That's about close to 10,000 votes. My mother's story is what brings me here as a candidate. She's 93 years old. She still lives on her own, does not need nursing care. I get her groceries and take care of her needs. In doing her taxes, she owed $1,200 in taxes on less than $26,000 income. I wrote the check. 2 months later, she received a letter from the Government of Canada telling her that she was being cut off from her guaranteed income supplement. Tom Mulcair and the NDP have a plan to bring 200,000 seniors out of poverty by increasing CPP and GIS benefits, investing in the economy by lowering taxes for small business, invest in medium-sized business with an innovation tax credit. They invest in their business for growth and job creation and get a tax credit for doing so. $15 a day quality daycare. It is proven in Quebec that the system does work. Thank you for coming out, and I look forward to an interesting debate.
Thank you, James.
Thank you, Glenn, and thank you all for taking time out of your busy schedules to be here today. My name is Tim Lewis. I'm a federal liberal candidate at Kitchener-Conestoga. I guess we do a little bio thing. I'm a full-time musician, singer, songwriter, piano player. I live in Kitchener with my wife and two teenage children. And since this is a chamber event, we want to keep things moving, so I'll just kind of get right down to the business of our liberal platform. Canada is experiencing a period of no economic growth, and middle-class Canadians have not had a decent raise in 30 years. Our innovation and productivity are on decline right now. So we need investment now, not in years, so businesses and entrepreneurs can succeed, grow, and innovate. The Liberals have a three-point plan, which will create jobs with the most significant infrastructure investment in Canadian history, almost $60 billion in new funding over the next 10 years. Growing the middle class by raising taxes on the wealthiest 1% and cutting taxes for middle class Canadians. And then helping those who are working hard to join the middle class by investing in essential social infrastructure, including affordable housing and childcare, as well as providing more money to help families with the high cost of raising their kids. By making the right choices and choosing to invest right away, we can bring real immediate change to the lives of all Canadians. Thank you.
How soon will your party deliver a balanced budget? We begin with Bob.
Times have been bad. Times have been bad for a long time, since at least 2008, and possibly starting a little bit beyond that. And conditions in some of the other countries, in European countries, have shown that austerity measures just make things worse for people. There was a large vote in Greece a little while back where people voted massively against austerity measures, yet the government in Greece decided to implement further austerity measures regardless, and the Greek economy is tanking. Austerity measures are not a way to solve recessionary problems. The best way to do that is for the government to actually invest in businesses. And in order to do that, there needs to be money available, and that money needs to be borrowed. So initially, to bring an economy back up to speed, a government needs to incur some debt, some deficit, in order to re-stimulate the economy. How long will that take? Well, it depends on how quickly the economy gets stimulated. Certainly, subsidies towards large industries, those industries that can't afford to fail, those subsidies have just gone down a black hole and are never seen again. That's not the way to stimulate the economy. Instead, it should be small businesses that get stimulated. So, how soon can the Green Party deliver a balanced budget? If the economy were to recover immediately, probably pretty darn soon. But the budget that's delivered by the Green Party actually shows a balanced budget for every year for the next 5 years. This is without doing a great deal of additional expenditure and subsidies. So, to answer the question, right now.
All right, thank you, Bob. James?
I don't think it's any secret that NDP has a track record for balanced budgets. Tommy Douglas, 17 in a row. The only exception would have to be Bob Ray, who was actually a Liberal. We got caught on that one. You're going to see changes in Alberta. They're going to start seeing balanced budgets. Tom has promised a balanced budget on our first budget. It's prudent. His plan is going to work. We're going to invest in childcare at $15 a day. We're going to bring it forward. Our budget will be released before the advanced polls come out. It will be fully costed as well. You'll be able to see where the money's coming from and where it's going.
All right. Thank you very much, James.
Anything? We talked about balanced budgets and everybody looked this way. So the Liberal Party is actually the only party that's being honest with Canadians. We're in recession right now, and this one I've heard people refer to as the Harper recession, because we're the only G7 country right now that's in recession. That's by the Conservatives' own definition of what a recession is. So the Liberal Party, we're going to practice smart economics, and we're going to grow this country out of recession and deficit by investing in our economy, creating priority jobs, and growing our country. We've got a serious commitment to balance the budget in 2 years. And we're willing to have modest deficits for those 2 years, just under $10 billion a year, and return to surplus by 2019. Canada's a $2 trillion economy, so when you think of $10 billion, a lot of people say that's a lot. To a $2 trillion economy, that's one-half of 1% of our economy. And what we're going to make sure we do is keep the debt-to-GDP ratio very low, and that's a very important measure. And if you want to contrast, the $10 billion deficit we're talking about is half of Mr. Harper's average deficit for the last 10 years. See, deficits do no long-term harm as long as the debt-to-GDP ratio doesn't grow. And when people get scared about debts, if you're concerned about debts in Canada, it's actually a much more important debt than federal debt. That's household debt and private debt. And the Liberal plan has a plan to grow that middle class to get people out of their household debt as well.
Thank you, Tim. Finally, on this question, Joe.
Okay, thank you. As I indicated in my opening remarks, we have returned to not only balanced budget, but surplus budget 1 year ahead of schedule. When we entered the economic downturn of 2008-09, we committed to large infrastructure programs, which some of them I've listed that are here in this area. And the idea here was to stimulate the economy in the short term, but more importantly, to improve our infrastructure in the long term. Canada's current debt is $617 billion. The interest on that is $26 billion a year. What could we do with $26 billion a year invested in healthcare or environment or any number of other issues that we could cite as a priority? Since 1990, we have spent $1 trillion in interest as Canadians. Yes, our debt to GDP ratio is low. In fact, it's the lowest in the developed world. Our debt to GDP ratio is 32% compared to Japan's at 122%. My colleague says that austerity is not the way to go, and he cited Greece as an example. Well, GDP growth in Greece since 2006 has been minus 20%. Canada's GDP growth since 2006 has been 16%, higher than the US at 13, higher than Germany at 13, higher than France at 7, higher than Japan at 4.4. The way to balance our budget is to reduce taxes and to keep their debt levels low so communities can attract investment by businesses who will create jobs for the people here who want to work.
Thank you, Harold. I know that Bob wanted to interject over by
Mr. Albrecht says that the conservative budget is balanced, and I think those numbers magically appeared a few weeks back when it was determined that the conservative budget is indeed balanced because they haven't been spending the money that's been allocated to programs. Programs that fund the veterans, programs that fund healthcare, programs that fund all manner of infrastructure services. So by recycling those very same numbers and calling it a savings, yes, the budget is perhaps balanced, but our veterans are doing without, our infrastructure is doing without, and I think that the economy and Canadians are a poorer as a result of that.
James, do you want to say something?
With respect to reduction in taxes, I just finished my opening statement. Somehow, I know that it is going towards the wealthiest Canadians. My mom hasn't seen any of that yet. I don't know where those tax cuts, the tax savings to the regular people are.
I know Harold wanted to say
something. My colleague commented about cuts to veterans. We have invested record amounts in care for our veterans. I respect our veterans greatly. I've had the privilege of traveling to Juneau and to Vimy and to speak personally with those veterans, as well as many of our Afghan vets who have returned to Canada. So in terms of respect for veterans, we have given them the respect they deserve. Certainly in terms of our budget, we have increased from $2.8 billion for our veterans in 2005 when we took office to 3.6. 2.8 to 3.6. That is not a cut, that is an increase. During a time when the number of veterans that are served by Veterans Affairs Canada dropped from 219,000 to 199,000. So we are caring for our veterans. You can always find a case or two where someone falls through the cracks, and when that happens, you can be sure that our office goes to bat for them and tries to find the resources that they deserve and are entitled to.
I'm not sure that people are saying about your respect for veterans. We're talking about your boss, Mr. Harper. He has shown disdain for veterans, and I don't need to tell anybody numbers in here. The image of the Minister of Veterans Affairs running away from Canadians refusing to answer questions, I think, says more than any number could.
All right, thank you, gentlemen. Moving along, again, we're with the jobs and the economy. And this is question number two. An increasing number of businesses in the region across all economic sectors are dependent on export markets for their growth and for the creation of new jobs. Over the past few months, a potential trade agreement with a number of Pacific Rim nations, referred to as the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or TPP, has generated significant discussion across the country. The question is quite simple. What is your party's position on the TPP? James?
I've actually been getting emails from farmers through the region, the egg farmers, the chicken farmers, the dairy farmers. They are scared of this deal. It's we support trade agreements, but we want to make sure that we're protecting our farmers, our growers, and our way of life. I believe Tom last night, he was talking about the agreements, saying that some of the agreements that have been brought forward shouldn't go to countries where they don't respect, have the same respect for the workers there that we have for the workers in Canada. The farmers know that it's not a good deal. They don't want it going through. And Tom is not standing for that agreement.
Yes.
Well, Kitchener-Conestoga, as we all know, is very diverse, very got urban and rural at the same time. And there's no such thing as a typical farm around here. The Liberals support free trade. Canada's a trading nation that needs free trade agreements like the TPP because they create jobs for Canadians and contribute to economic growth and long-term prosperity. The Liberal Party of Canada supports supply management. We have in the past signed free trade agreements that did not jeopardize that. So Canada has historically managed to keep supply management while giving other countries access to our markets. It doesn't have to be any different now. But how can Canadians trust that Mr. Harper's protecting supply management and negotiating with good faith when he's acting with his usual secrecy and keeping Canadians in the dark, ignoring the very people that are doing the heavy lifting in our economy? The Harper Conservatives conducted the TPP negotiations in secrecy without consultation. And I can tell you that Liberals will act differently, working with farmers and producers to bring back fairness and strengthen the heart of the Canadian economy.
Thank you, Carol.
Yes, well, trade certainly is an important factor in improving our economy. There's no sector in this area or in all of Canada that isn't dependent on free trade with many, many, many countries, whether it started back with the Canada-US free trade or NAFTA, recently the Canada-Korea free trade. All of these trade agreements give access for our products to international markets. The EU free trade agreement will give access to 500 million more consumers. Korea free trade to 50 more million. And the Trans-Pacific Partnership potentially 800 million. We have to be at the table in these negotiations, and it's fine for us to say we're going to totally protect our sectors, and we are. We're going to protect the supply management system. But to say there will be no tweaking or no concessions made at all for any sector is unrealistic. When you go to a bargaining table, there always has to be some give and take. Recently, we signed the Canada-EU Free Trade Agreement, and dairy farmers did give access to up to 3% of niche market cheese, and that does concern them, but there is no way that that is dismantling the supply management system. We have gone on record, we will protect the three pillars of supply management, and dairy farmers, poultry and egg farmers can be assured that the deal that we signed will not jeopardize their industry.
Thank you, Harold. Final answer on this question, Bob.
It's really difficult to make commentary on trade agreements like TPP, because all these trade agreements are being held in secret behind closed doors, and the language of the agreements not being made available, sometimes not even to the cabinet ministers who are supposed to be negotiating these deals. Yet the language for these agreements is being made available to industry. So who's really running the free trade agreements? Who's really negotiating that? Is it industry or is it your government? And certainly it isn't the people of Canada who are able to do that. An additional problem is as Mr. Lewis mentioned, we have supply chain management. It's been good for Canada. During the worst of the recession, I still knew what I would be paying for an egg the next day. If you're dependent on a free trade agreement or any sort of other trade agreement where external agencies can set the price of things, we have no idea how much I'm going to be paying for an egg or how much you, the farmer, will be paid in turn for that egg. So, stability is an important thing that Canada has managed to achieve without these trade deals and without jeopardizing the Canadian produce. And the last thing that I want to say is that you, the farmers, will be competing directly with foreign entities. So if you're having to compete for that egg market with China, for example, we have no idea what sort of quality standards are going to be applied to that produce or material. And we have no idea what sort of working place conditions are going to exist there. And something that I've learned about is that some of these external countries are going to be able to sue the Canadian government if they're not happy with the results of whatever trade agreement that they've reached. And we're on the hook for this for some 30 years locked into that. with very little chance of negotiating or even seeing what it is that we've agreed to. So the Green Party position is certainly very much against TPP. We're in favor of open government, transparent government. And that means that the language for any of these deals needs to be made available to the people who will be most affected by it, and that's you, the farmers, and the citizens of Canada.
Bubba and Harold wants.
My colleague implies that somehow the safety of our food is in jeopardy with free trade agreements. Nothing could be further from the truth. We import all kinds of food now, and it's subject to very rigid, rigorous standards. That will not change under a free trade agreement. The safety and quality of our food will still be monitored, and you can be sure that the safety of your food will be as good as it is now.
All right, thank you, Tim.
Oh, sorry, Tim.
Go ahead.
Yeah, there are significant cuts in food inspection and safety. That's not right. I don't know what to say. Significant cuts, I don't know how you can say that.
If you could show me significant cuts, I'd like to see them, because we have invested in more CFIA inspectors than we've ever had in Canada. That's not a cut.
Right, thank you, gentlemen. The next question is the shortest of the afternoon. Will your party raise corporate taxes?
Yes.
So give yourself some time to think about this one. Tim, you start with this one.
I guess we're keeping it simple. No, we will not raise corporate taxes.
Harold?
Yeah, absolutely. There's no plan in our platform or in the history of our party of raising taxes. Our party has been one of lowering taxes for those businesses who are creating jobs. The best way to improve our economy is to lower taxes, encourage investment in Canada, especially for the small business sector. And our plan to reduce the small business tax rate from 11 down to 9% will increase investment. The small business economy of our country is the backbone of our economy. And to raise taxes on those businesses to create a few extra dollars supposedly in the coffers will not work. In fact, studies have shown that when taxes are reduced, the actual total income dollars increases into the public treasury. So raising business taxes, raising corporate taxes will have a very negative effect on our economy, and I certainly would stand against that, and our party does as well. And our track record has shown that we've reduced them in every way.
Let me give a very complex answer to a simple question. Yes and no. Large corporation tax rates have been reduced and reduced and reduced under Mr. Albrecht's government to the point where there are insufficient tax revenues to pay for things like Veterans Affairs offices, which have all been closed all over the country. And so the Green Party plan is to increase large corporation tax levels from current 14 to 15% back up to 19%, which is where they were about 5 or 6 years ago. Tax rates used to be at about 28%, so this is still a significant tax cut over what they were 15 years ago. Canada is at the bottom end of tax revenues from large corporations, and those tax cuts have not prevented corporations and industry from shutting themselves down. Kitchener frame, some software industries have all packed up shop and moved away back to the United States, where tax rates may be higher, so it's not the low tax rates that are keeping businesses in Canada. And to the other part of the question, no, we will not be raising taxes for small businesses. It's a small business sector that's actually keeping much of the economy alive. So we'll actually be reducing the small business tax from 11% down to 9%.
Thank you, Bob. James?
I realize the question was on corporate tax increases, yes. From 15 to 17%, and that is still lower than what it was when Harper first took government. The money is going to be used to help our plan, to help Canadians get back on their feet, to have a lot of my train of thought. I'll come back to it. Yes.
All right, Gina, and Tim wanted to rebut.
I just got a text message, and apparently hell has frozen over because myself and my conservative colleague agree on this one 100%. So.
All right. Moving right along, any more rebuttals to that?
Well, just
on corporate taxes, Harold?
Well, just a point on taxes. Certainly the NDP has never seen a tax they wouldn't want to increase. But there's no question that you cannot tax your way into prosperity. And this is what the NDP misses time and time again. They think the way to increase our economy is through increased taxes. It doesn't work. It hasn't worked. It didn't work in Ontario. It won't work in Alberta. And it certainly won't work in Canada.
If elected,
what measures will your party take to support employers, especially small and medium enterprises, to overcome barriers to hiring immigrants. And Harold, you start with this one.
Well, thank you for the question. It's clear that there is a big mismatch between those who are coming here from other countries and the skills they have and their ability to use those skills in their profession. Too often, those barriers are put up by associations. My previous profession, dentistry, medicine, dentistry, pharmacy, many of these professions are putting up barriers that make it more difficult for new immigrants to actually do the job that they've been trained to do. But there are other challenges. And so one of the challenges is the issue of language training. You can be totally qualified in the country of origin, but until your language is proficient enough to be able to practice that particular skill here in Canada, that's a barrier. So we have to work on language skills. We have to work on walking with these people to find those resources that will help them integrate. But when it comes to skilled trades, I think it's important to note that many of our skilled trade mismatches are a result of long-term thinking that university is the only way for students to go. I would like to see us begin to value a skilled trade in the same way as we value professions right now. And that has to start in the elementary school system. That has to start in your homes when you're talking to your kids. So that we view colleges in the same way we view universities. That we view trade the same way that we view professions, and that we respect blue-collar workers the same way we respect white-collar workers. The only way we can do that is to invest in training opportunities, and this government has invested record amounts in Conestoga College to help them actually double their capacity when it comes to turning out skilled workers, whether it's in electrical, computer technology, engineering. Many of these fields are short of workers, and there are many people not working. What we have to do is find ways to retrain and help these people find the skills that they need to fill those jobs.
Thank you, Bob.
Certainly, there's a lot of an influx of workers here in Waterloo Region. I see a lot of people coming in from Mexico, from the United States, to help with farming and harvesting around here. So this is an important part of the economy here. I don't believe that the Green Party has any indications at all that they would reduce the amount of foreign labor that's allowed here. Certainly, foreign labor needs to be treated well, no less than regular Canadians are, but there's no plan at all to reduce or restrict that any further. There's also a plan to increase the amount of education that's available to anybody living in Canada or any permanent residents within Canada. So if foreign workers want to apply for residency, certainly they would be able to take advantage of the very same programs that are available to Canadians.
All right. James?
Thank you. Our plan, an NDP government, will speed up the process times. We're going to reduce the backlogs. We're going to give greater priority to family unification, especially to keep children and parents together. And we'll create an immigration ombudsman to investigate problems and resolve complaints on the doorsteps. I'm talking to people, they've been in the country waiting for 8 years for the process to complete, and they're still not there. The other issue, we will restore the $30 million to the foreign credential program that Stephen Harper promised, and he didn't deliver,
and he did deliver.
And we'll make the visa system more transparent and accountable with clear rules and new appeal processes. The issues are with the credentials issue. These people are trained in their country. I mean, I'm a sheet metal worker. We had immigrants coming over, their millwrights, shipbuilders, welders, fitters, things like that. They come across, and their cards aren't their tickets for the work that they do aren't recognized. So they have to start at the bottom. They either work their way up back into the trade that they wanted, or they start off in the small, low-paying jobs that are out there, the only thing that they can get, instead of taking something in the skilled area that they're at and getting a good-paying job.
We need a new plan for our immigration system that's grounded in compassion and economic opportunity for everyone. Our future success is largely driven by attracting talented people from around the world, and our diversity not only brings economic and social rewards, but with Canada's aging population, having a robust, effective, and efficient immigration system is critical to our long-term growth. And during the Harper decade, the immigration system has been mismanaged and very much politicized. The big thing that Mr. Villeneuve mentioned was family reunification, which is very important to the Liberals. and we've committed to nearly doubling the budget for family class immigration processing and doubling the number of new applications for parents and grandparents. And here's why. Under the current system, if someone comes over and works, they have a work visa with no hope for pathway to citizenship. They're going to work, they're going to take that money, and they're going to send it home to another economy. If they know they're on a pathway to citizenship here, they're going to save their money, they're going to bring over a spouse. That spouse moves in, hopefully with the children too. Now they're saving up money to bring in a grandparent. That grandparent comes over, they have child care now, and they can go out and both work. Now they need a new car, or a second car, new clothing. They grow up, maybe you bring a brother, and now you're getting into a bigger house. That's the long-term plan that brings compassion and economic sense.
Thank you, Tim Carroll.
Just to point out that last year our government set a record in terms of immigration. We accepted a record number of immigrants as Canadian citizens, more than 250,000 last year alone. And more than 1.6 million immigrants to Canada have become citizens since we took office in 2006. We're accepting 20% more immigrants than under the previous government, and we have reduced the delays and the backlog significantly. So there's no question about the improvement on the immigration file under the Conservative government's watch.
Anybody else want to do the director?
No.
Moving along, again, we're still on the subject of the economy. As you're aware, the region has a large post-secondary student population with the two universities and the aforementioned college, Conestoga College. The Canadian Chamber of Commerce has proposed that additional government incentives be offered for employers to increase the number of co-op placements and the number of internships that they provide. The question is, do you support this position on co-op programs, offering incentives to increase the number of co-op placements? And Bob, we'll start with this one.
Short answer, yes. Co-op placements provide valuable training to people, to young students who get into the workforce, gives them a chance to practice the skills that they've learned, and gives them a step up, resume items for those jobs. One of the important things that's been going on the last little while is unpaid internships, and having a paid co-op program available to students gives them the ability to sustain themselves, to be able to make a living at these co-op jobs. So yes, the Green Party is certainly in favor of expanding the co-op program and making paid work available to students.
Thank you, Bob.
The stance of Tom and the NDP is relatively the same as Bob Jonkman with the Green Party. We support it, we will fund it, we will work with the larger corporations to help the students get out there, making sure that they're paid and that they're treated fairly in the workplace. And again, the same thing with internships. We're against interns not being paid. We will bring that forward as well. I spoke with Stefan, who is the president of the University of Waterloo Students Union. He was actually interested in what we had to bring forward as far as more co-ops for the students to get them out there, to get them the experience that they need so that when they finish university, they'll be able to go out there. And he says that there are a large number of businesses that these students go to, and after they finish graduating, they are highly sought after by the companies that they went up to and they started their co-op program through to learn and gain experience. They've got a student that goes out there, they start to learn how things are done in that corporation, the corporation keeps them and gives them a well-paying job at the end.
Thank you, James. Tim?
One of the most persistent economic challenges we faced during the Harper decade is the lack of good jobs and opportunities for our young Canadians. The result is stubbornly high youth unemployment, and underemployment was a major problem as well. Canada's current youth unemployment is almost triple the rate of adults over age 25. I am a parent of two teenage children. This is the stuff that keeps me up at night. The lack of job opportunities for young Canadians place a heavy cost burden on their parents, who are increasingly supporting them through these challenging times, that's probably coming up for me, often forcing parents to deplete their retirement savings or increase household debt. Now, in our region, we have nearly 20,000 co-op placements, and the new Liberal government will invest $1.3 billion over 3 years to create jobs and opportunities for young Canadians so they can get a strong start in life. We're going to invest $40 million annually to create more co-op placements for students, and we will pay 25% of a co-op placement salary, up to $5,000. We're going to work with the provinces and the territories to develop and or expand the pre-apprenticeship training programs, which will provide up to $10 million a year to help young Canadians get the skills they need to enter trades. And for anyone out there who's looking to hire a co-op, this is a good one. We're going to waive the employer's employment insurance premiums for 12 months on any new net hire of a full-time employee. This will reduce the cost to employers by approximately $8 million a year. So we know how to cut taxes.
The final word on this question to Harold, notwithstanding any interjections later, if anyone else reply, feel free. But Harold gets to the final word on this one.
Yes, certainly the co-op program that UofW was sort of the pace setter in implementing certainly has had major success. I can't speak specifically to our government's plan on that. I don't recall having read that. However, let me say again what I said a few minutes ago in terms of recognizing our skilled trades equally with our university graduates. And the amount of effort and investment we've made in the skilled trades, there's no question in my mind that we would be open to that idea of also even increasing it to co-op students. But we made it easier for apprentices to get the hours they need to become tradespeople with the apprenticeship job creation tax credit. In 2013, 11,000 businesses and almost 70,000 apprentices benefited from this program. That was a 500% increase from when it was first started under our government in 2006, a 500% increase. But there are still more than 20,000 positions that can't be filled. Jobs looking for people. Without action, this number will grow to 50,000 by the end of the decade. And I don't need to tell you about the lack of skilled trade, whether it's electricians or plumbers or mechanics. This is an area that's going to be a crucial issue for us to face in the future. We have to improve our record on recognizing skilled trades equally to the professions.
You can revise anything that was said in response to that question.
Sure. As far as skills and trades, we're the Liberals have promised $500 million a year working with the provinces and working with the trades.
Final question in the category of the economy. Despite major global restructuring over the last 10 years or so, manufacturing still generates 1 in 5 jobs here in the Waterloo region. The question is, what does your party propose to help this sector, the manufacturing sector, both nationally and locally here in Kitchener-Conestoga? And we'll start with James.
Thank you. We are going to invest, as I said earlier, our small tax credits, our small business taxes are going to be reduced from 11% to 9%. We're going to have an innovation tax credit for some of the medium and large businesses around. For those who are familiar with the Kitchener area, there's been plenty of factories that have shut down, left town, Schneider's, the Bud plant, Firestone. When I was working in Firestone as a sheet metal worker doing some work, one of the guys that was in there, I knew him from high school, and he applauded me for taking the time to get a skilled trade. And he said, you know, if this place ever shut down, he said, I don't know what I would do. Not even a year after he'd said that, they closed that plant. They moved it south because they could pay less. There was no union there for them to worry about. So the people that were taking the jobs on had no job protection. He lived around the corner from me, and the word of a lie, within 4 months of him losing his job, he had to sell his house. We're going to invest small, medium, large. We're going to get the large businesses interested in Canada again through our innovation tax credits. They're going to buy properties, they'll build the buildings, they'll put Canadians to work, they'll be well-paying jobs, and that's where we stand.
Thank you, James. Tim?
we're looking also to invest in research and development, because nowadays manufacturing and technology are intricately linked, especially in our region. We've got fantastic incubators and accelerators. And you'll have to forgive me, this information came out about 2 hours ago, so I'm just checking this out here myself. We're going to invest an additional $100 million a year, each of the next 3 years, in an industrial research assistance program, which is going to be for small business innovation and research. And that's modeled after successful programs in the United States and Australia and Japan. And we're committed to look and focus on Canadian tech. Anytime we have a chance to work with our own region, we absolutely will. And basically, yeah. I'll get back to that. Right, this is 2 hours old.
Right, thank you very much. And Harold, over to you.
Thank you for the question. It's clear that many of the challenges that the manufacturing sector faces are not unique to the manufacturing sector, but are common for all small businesses and even corporations. And so things like reducing the EI premiums, things like continuing to reduce taxes are certainly important. But specific to the manufacturing sector, our recent government increased the continued the accelerated capital cost allowance, increasing it from the 30% write-off rate to a 50% write-off rate on the declining balance. And this allows long-term projects to be able to be developed. For example, if you're currently writing off at a 30% level, it takes 7 years to write down an investment in new equipment. And we know that with the rapid technology changes today, that once something is 7 years old, it's probably already obsolete. So we have to increase that capital cost allowance write-off. So by increasing it to 50%, it now only takes 4 years to write that down to a 90% level, at 90% of its original value. So that's one of the things that we're trying to do to encourage the manufacturing sector. We're also investing in the Automotive Supplier Innovation Fund. And this is to help small parts suppliers for the automotive industry to do research and development on fuel efficiency, emission improvements, safety, and technology. These are issues that I think we can work on together. And this sector, the automotive sector, has certainly shown incredible leadership in terms of taking advantage of these investments in research and development funds.
Thank you, Harold. Bob.
James mentioned a number of the industries that have shut down in Waterloo. It's not just industry and manufacturing that's been shutting down. It's also software industries. I'm thinking of the loss of Cisco and McAfee in Waterloo region that have both shut down. High-tech industries. What the Green Party wants to do is invest in sustainable technologies, possibly a shift in manufacturing of one type of vehicle to possibly electric vehicle manufacturing instead. There's an electric vehicle rebate program that the Green Party is proposing, as well as a national solar roof program. So those two industries are certainly up and coming and can replace, hopefully, the industries that are deciding that they no longer want to stay in Canada and have left the area. New industry needs to replace the old.
Thank you. Wraps up there.
Well, just one is to increase their opportunities to trade the products that they're manufacturing. We can manufacture all we want in Canada, but we don't have markets to sell those to, whether it's a European Free Trade Agreement or Korea, or even the proposed Trans-Pacific Partnership. We have to continue to expand our access to global markets. Canadian manufacturers can compete on the global scale, and certainly the quality and the quantity of material that they will provide will not only help the manufacturing sector and improve jobs here at home. For example, recently, Honda Canada announced that they're going to be building their CRV model right here in Alliston, Ontario. That's specifically for the European market, and that's a good export story that will increase manufacturing here in Canada.
The automotive industry is one of the three industries I'm hearing that is getting worried about getting sold out, along with the farmers and BC Forestry, the automotive. Actually, I think it was the Conservatives that said, get ready for some concessions on automotive. They're kind of trying to soften it up, so I'm not sure where that's going.
Yeah.
Okay. In mentioning the free trade and the way it works, currently the Toyota plant in Cambridge is looking to shut down a large portion of their plant where they manufacture the Corolla. They're building a plant in Mexico. So they're going to take the car that they're making in Cambridge with all those workers, they're shipping it to Mexico, they're going to build it in Mexico, and then they're going to ship it back up to Canada with no tariffs. We haven't heard anything. We have not, I'm in the construction trades, we have not heard anything of what they're going to do with the side of the Corolla that they're shutting down.
Well, it's pretty clear, Mr. Moderator, that the Toyota company is already committed to increasing the manufacturing of the Lexus at that plant. They're simply retooling, and those jobs will be there for the workers at Toyota.
All right. As noted earlier, businesses of all sizes and sectors across the region are dependent upon exports for sustained and long-term growth. One of the barriers to that growth is the aging condition of Canada's transportation infrastructure and the ability of business to move as efficiently as possible their products to export position. The question is, what do you propose to address Canada's infrastructure challenges? And Tim, you start this one.
10 years of ignoring infrastructure has caused crumbling infrastructure. And I know I sat down with the mayor of Kitchener and all the townships, and they spoke as one voice, as most of the municipalities across the country have said. It's just been neglected. Now, over the last several decades, our cities have been growing at rapid rates, and our cities will only continue to keep growing. So traffic congestion and gridlock is also a big problem. In order to grow the economy, we're going to have to get people moving. So even though municipalities deliver more than 60% of the services to Canada, to citizens, they're only collecting between 8 and 12% of every tax dollar. So we need help from the federal government. So this is one of the major platforms of the Liberal Party. We're going to quadruple federal investment in public transit over the next decade to almost $20 billion. Ultimately, it's a $60 billion investment in infrastructure, and that's three separate components. One is your transit. The second is social infrastructure, which is affordable housing, seniors' homes, and childcare. And the third is environmental infrastructure, which is sewers and environmental protection. So this is the platform. The biggest part of our platform right now is a massive investment in infrastructure here. And the good thing is, you're going to hear all sorts of numbers from my colleague about how much money was promised, but that's money that lapses. That's money that they put out there and then take back. And so to prevent that, the Liberal Party has said, what we're going to do is, if money is supposed to be, is earmarked to be spent on infrastructure, and it's not, that money goes directly to the municipalities in a way that already exists right now. The municipalities are getting a gas tax transfer. So we're going to, if that money does not get spent on the projects it's supposed to, immediately get the gas tax transfer gets topped up, and the municipalities who know exactly where the money needs to go, they get the money.
No question about the importance of infrastructure investments. And during my opening remarks, I listed a few of the projects that were funded in Woolwich alone. I could relist some of those. But the ones that are specifically in terms of improving our competitiveness and reducing gridlock on our roads, the one that I'm most proud of, quite frankly, is our expansion of Highway 8 Bridge over the Grand River. I don't know how many times prior to that I was stuck on that little two-lane road trying to get across the Grand River. Well, since that highway has been expanded to 8 lanes, virtually, not very often, that you'll find a problem at that bridge. So I think it's important that we recognize the cost of to our transportation sector when they're sitting in a traffic jam. So we are continuing to invest in infrastructure. Our government in 2007 invested $33 billion in the Building Canada Fund. And we just re-announced in 2013 a $53 billion 10-year program for infrastructure funding. Much of that funding is through the gas tax fund, which we have doubled. We have indexed it to inflation, and we've legislated that it's to be permanent, so that when a municipality like Woolwich Township is planning for the future, they know already this year how much they'll be getting next year. Let me just list a few of the projects and then also the amount of money that the gas tax fund has given to Woolwich Township since we've been in office. We replaced the Shewitt Bridge. The Breslau Community Center helped to rebuild that.
We helped to fund an economic development plan here for Woolwich so they could increase that economic development for their township. The Floridale Road and Bridge, Samuel Street, Snyder Avenue, upgrades to the water and waste system in Elmira, the Snyder Park lighting, Line 86 rehabilitation, Regional Road 22 or Northfield Drive from 86 to the Waterloo-Wellington boundary, Catherine Street, Northfield Drive, Highway 8, Conestoga College, $40 million invested in Conestoga College. This is crucial infrastructure that helps for the future. The LRT, a project that will impact our region for many years to come in terms of reducing gridlock, reducing greenhouse gas emissions, and preserving farmland. And finally, investments to the airport here in the Waterloo region. The improvements to safety issues at the airport, these are things that will serve us well in the future.
Thank you, Harold and Bob.
Nice list, but most of those items aren't federal infrastructure items.
They were funded by federal.
But the funding goes into provincial transfers, and very rarely into municipal transfers. For large projects such as LRT, certainly it does. But the I can tell when I'm traveling on a Waterloo Region Road and coming to Woolwich, I'm traveling on a Woolwich Region Road. The Woolwich Region Roads have much worse surface on them, and that's probably because that infrastructure hasn't been paid for properly through transfer taxes, through transfer payments. So yes, there can be much more improvement made in that regard. To me, transportation infrastructure means transit, public transit. I've been traveling to Toronto for the last year on a contract. There's only two trains going to Toronto in the morning and two trains coming back. A definite impediment to people being able to find the work that they need. There's certainly no municipal transit in Elmira today where people can work, get a job at Conestoga Mall, because they can't get home from their jobs at night. So there's municipal infrastructure that needs to be, municipal transit that needs to be better funded. And certainly the Green Party is very much in favor of keeping up those transfers to municipalities to be able to improve their infrastructure there as well. I myself would benefit from that.
Thank you, Bob. And finally, to James, and we have a couple of rebuttals. Finally, we have one, and I saw Harold indicating he would like to want to rebut later as well. But the final answer to the question goes to you.
Another 1 cent transfer from the gas tax is going to create $1.3 billion a year that's going to be put towards infrastructure, not just roadways. It's going to be funding transit. It's going to bring forward a plan that's concrete, stable. You're promising that for 20 years. Some of the issues that come up, again, same thing with the transfers to the provinces, and the province is not transferring the funds. Tom has assured the municipalities that if they come forward with a concrete plan and concrete value for what they want, that they'll get the funding. An example of this is in the city of Kitchener, where I live. We've been getting, with our water and gas bill, these little pamphlets, and it shows the aging of the pipes, for the water pipes and for the sewer pipes. The new mayor that just came in, new city council that just came in, raised our taxes 1.3%. And my thinking was, why not start at zero and see if you can go backwards? With an infrastructure plan that we have going forward, hopefully we'll be able to stop the city from saying, we need to fix the infrastructure, the taxpayer has to pay for it. Be the federal government, put your applications in, we're going to get rid of a lot of the red tape, the process is going to be much faster, we'll get the infrastructure jobs done. As far as I see, these little papers that they're starting to send out with my gas and my water bill, is all they're telling me is, guess what, you're either going to be paying more for gas and water, or we're going to tax you again the next time the budget comes out.
Thank you, James. And I know that Tim wanted to rebut or rebut.
I do. It seems to Mr. Harper's concerns that infrastructure seems to need repair right before elections. When I'm stuck in traffic, having someone promise that down the road in a number of years that we will get to fixing this road is not good enough. The Liberal Party has promised, or that is part of our platform, is that we will spend and invest that money right now, not down the road, if we ever get there.
Harold?
Well, just to rebut the last statement, yeah, right before elections, if you count 2013 as right before the election, that does count. You're absolutely right. This was announced in 2013. $53 billion Building Canada Fund was announced. In terms of my other colleague, Mr. Jonkman, who says that the money hasn't been invested federally, there are some municipal councillors in the room and mayors and former mayors, and we know that these funds that were invested were funded at a one-third ratio. One-third province, one-third federal, and one-third municipality. If the municipality doesn't believe that a project is worth investing in, provincial and federal governments aren't telling you what to invest in. The decisions are made here at the local region. That's where it should happen. But when they're deemed to be a reasonable project that's good for the township, the province and the feds come along and they fund it at one-third, one-third, one-third. Now, we don't advance the money before the project starts, by the way. We pay the bills when they come in. They're invoiced and the bills are paid as they arrive.
One-third, one-third, one-third.
One-third of not enough is still not enough.
What's enough?
Anybody else? James?
With respect to Tim's comment on come close to election time, all of a sudden the wallet opens up and the spending happens. There was a lady in town that I was speaking to, and her comment was directly related to that, with the funding that all of a sudden came out, where the, I believe it was the Remembrance Day Memorial, and the statue right before the rip drop got funding to get fixed.
I think what my colleague is referring to is the Canada 150 project. This is a project that is to celebrate the birth of our country 150 years ago, and the reality is those applications had been in process for some time, and in order to enable community groups to plan accordingly when that project would happen, it was already approved. It was simply a matter of announcing it. So if we hadn't announced it, there'd be no way the project would have gone forward. So there are projects, for example, that just because you announce it in June doesn't mean it can start in June. It may have to wait till another construction year. It may have to wait till a break in the school year, for example. We had an example like that where they wanted to put an elevator into a particular building, but they couldn't do it while the school students were using it. They had to wait till a break. So we have to give that flexibility to community groups when they apply for this funding for the Canada 150 project. It certainly makes sense to get the announcement made so that when they are ready, they can proceed accordingly.
Tim?
Having a program thrown out quickly, giving no one time to apply, and very few people did because it was confusing and not many people applied, and then saying how much money you're spending, is that's not funding. I have no sense.
I just have to go back to the doorstep where I was talking to the lady, and you just finished saying that it was there for a while, the application was there for a while, it was a matter of releasing the funding, you're making the announcement, and I'm just repeating what I heard at the doorstep, don't shoot the messenger. She just said, you know, oh, perfect timing, right before the election, here he is. That's all I got at the doorstep.
Well, I guess I would rather have it before the election than never happen. So if the community, I think, is worthy of those investments, because there was an election call does not mean that the announcement shouldn't have made it. At the point that we made the announcement, there was no election call.
All right. This next question, you guys kind of touched on it earlier, some more than others, so but feel free to expand if you wish. It's a very simple question, and it is, what are the priority infrastructure projects for one of the regions? Some are obvious and some need to be discussed at haven't been already. What are the priority infrastructure projects for Waterloo Region? And Harold, we'll start with you.
Yeah, well, again, that's a good question, but I'm not sure I'm prepared to speak on behalf of Waterloo Region. They should be the ones here asking us what they're telling us what their priorities are. As I said in my previous comments, it's the region, it's the municipality that comes to us and gives us their list, and then those are studied and we decide accordingly. But for me, I would say that one of the projects that is currently being funded, the LRT, is a high priority, and we've already announced the funding for that. The bill hasn't been paid yet. The bill will be paid as we proceed with that. But beyond that, at this point for Waterloo Region, I would simply say to keep doing what we're doing in place of replacing infrastructure, aging infrastructure for wastewater treatment, water infrastructure, and replacing and improving some of our bridges and highways.
Thank you, Harold.
It would be public transit, definitely public transit, both municipal public transit such as LRT. When the LRT was first announced several years ago, there was a meeting that we had, one of the public meetings in just north of St. Jacobs. And the idea back in those days was to actually bring the LRT all the way up to Elmira. I'm not entirely sure what happened there, but I believe that the funding wasn't available for that sort of thing. It would be wonderful to have an LRT come all the way in here, as the trains used to do through the tracks where that they no longer do. And provincial, regional transit as well. Having all-day GO train service would be a good thing. It's a provincial initiative, that is, but it will certainly benefit from infrastructure transfer payments from the federal government.
Tim?
What's that?
It's all right. My mom does it to me all the time. Go ahead.
No, it's all cool.
Yeah, I don't want nothing to do with it. Sorry, go to this Pittsburgh game, sir. You guys, I had my head down. I took my mind off of the order for a nanosecond. Yeah, so Bob's fault now is your turn. Okay.
All right.
Sir. And your name again? Don't tell me.
We will focus on public transit. It's a matter of getting communities moving, a matter of getting people back and forth to where they need to be. Estimates put a cost at $1.2 billion per year in Metro Vancouver area and a staggering $11 billion in Greater Toronto area. The cost for people stuck in traffic. Tom's plan, it's a better transit plan. We're going to tackle the gridlock. We're going to cut commute times across Canada, getting our communities on track, quality public transit while growing our economy. By the end of the first term, our 20-year term, again, our plan will put $1.3 billion every year into predictable and transparent transit investments across Canada. Municipalities will be able to plan long-term with dedicated revenue to fund their priorities. And instead of complicated application processes where a municipality has to compete with other cities, this fund will transfer funds directly and annually to all municipalities offering public transit. It will also fund transit expansion and repairs already approved locally and provincially using a formula to be determined with each province. And in addition to this, new transit funding, municipalities will continue to have the choice to also invest their gas tax funds on their transit priorities. The NDP transit strategy will increase Canada's GDP by $2 billion a year and create 31,000 good quality middle class jobs in manufacturing, construction and transit operations. It will make Canada an industrial world leader in transit innovation, research and development, and manufacturing. And we all feel the same way that are in the Kitchener area. We can't wait for the LRT project to be completed.
All right, James. And Tim.
What's your name? All right. Well, I enjoy answering this one because this is the answer to this is sort of, what am I hearing at the door? That's the way I look at this one. I managed to sit down with the mayors of all the townships in Kitchener, and also knocking on thousands and thousands and thousands of doors with a little notepad, taking down what people's ideas, what their hopes are, what they want for Canada. So this is the wish list from of our local issues, which is a lot of what everyone else is talking about. Strengthening the local economy, people want good, steady jobs. I like this one. Working together at all levels of government. The government, federal government, needs to talk to the provinces, needs to talk to the municipalities, and also, regardless of political parties, they need to talk across the board too. That's what people want. People want cooperation, and we're not getting that. Also, people want environmental protection, including healthy local food system and water quality. Traffic congestion, we've all touched on that already. And every single township and the mayor is talking about infrastructure such as roads, bridges, and sewers, and then also addressing poverty issues, including affordable housing. This is a direct list from everything that I've heard over the last month, and I'm proud to bring it up
here.
Just to point out that when we do discuss these infrastructure funding issues, we're always working with the Federation of Canadian Municipalities that are active partners in the decisions that we make, as well as the AMO, the Association for Municipalities of Ontario. We don't work in isolation on these things. And I neglected to mention earlier, and I want to agree with my colleague,
my green colleague, who said that all day, two-way goal training is certainly a priority. I've been working on that prior to the election, and I would support anything we can do to make that a reality, because the current service is inadequate, it's too slow, and certainly it would improve our ability in terms of addressing economic needs, not only in our region, but of all across the border between here and Toronto.
Tim?
Yes, along my wish list, because you reminded me, yes, LRT, GO train, and also connecting the townships to Kitchener, as far as transit is concerned. And then a little plug, because I'm actually proud of this, the federal Canadian municipalities actually endorses the Liberal plan for our infrastructure. They basically have endorsed it, which is very rare.
Ms. Albrecht says that the federal government has met with the Canadian municipalities. That may be so, but the Canadian federal government, Mr. Harper's government, has not wanted to meet with the provincial government for the longest time, if they have at all. The Green Party proposes a council of Canadian governments that includes both the municipalities and the governing bodies, such as the Native Canadians, Métis, Inuit peoples, and as a cooperation initiative, this would certainly get the needs of the various municipalities and provinces and territories to the federal government's attention. Regular scheduled meetings, open and cooperative government is what the Green Party is proposing, unlike what we've seen from the Conservative government.
Next question, again, you kind of hinted at it, but feel free to expand. What are your party's priorities for public transit? Do you support expanded two-way, all-day, GO train service for Waterloo Region? What are your party's priorities for public transit? Do you support expanded two-way, all-day, GO train service for the region? And Bob gets to start this.
At the risk of repeating myself, yes, I'm very much in favor of public transit and certainly two-way GO train service, and the Green Party will provide the funding or will provide supplements to the funding to achieve that.
James?
I've already covered our topic on that. Again, we supported two-way all-day transit back and forth to Toronto. Same issue. It's something that's needed. It will take a lot of congestion off of 401. I travel that way to work every morning, and sometimes I have to phone in letting them know I'm stuck in traffic, I might be a little bit late. If there was transit that ran at 5:30 in the morning or 6 o'clock in the morning, so I could be at work for 7:30 when I need to, I travel from the west end of Kitchener to the middle of Cambridge, I would take transit. It wouldn't be an issue. I wouldn't mind at all. I mean, I consider the amount of money that I would save on fuel sitting in traffic, it wouldn't be an issue. And it's something that needs to be tackled in the deed by the next governing body.
Thank you, James. Tim?
Well, I brought out my wish list of what voters want, and they wanted cooperation across party lines. I think we're about to get that right now for the first time tonight. Bob wants it. We all want the two-way GO train. The municipalities want it. The province wants it, and the federal government. Well, the Liberals have committed to working with the province. That's the missing piece right there. Having the federal government talk to the provinces, and the Liberals have committed to meet with the provinces. One of the very first things they do, meet with the provinces and get that money flowing, those transfer plans flowing, and make the two-way GO happen.
Harold.
Yes, I did mention earlier, Glenn, the Building Canada Fund at $53 billion a year, and a big part of that is actually designated for the Urban Transit Fund. And I think you will remember significant funding announced for the LRT, as well as significant funding for subway in Toronto. And an expanded two-way GO train, obviously I'm supportive of that. But one that I neglected to mention earlier that isn't public transit, but is going to make an incredible difference in terms of infrastructure and avoiding gridlock, is the Windsor-Detroit Bridge. The twinning of that bridge is something that's way past due, and this government has finally taken action on it, and will be constructing that bridge over the next number of years.
Thank you.
Well, to add, I think another cross-party idea is to have high-speed rail transit all the way from Montreal down to London, Sarnia, Windsor. It's a huge industrial corridor along that section there, and very much underserviced by public transit today. So I think all the parties are agreed that would be something that we would want to implement as well.
James?
Just one other small thing. The Grand River Transit now still runs out to Elmira. I think it's important to get the times that it runs extended in the evenings, to get those so that mom and dad don't have to jump in their car and run back to Waterloo or wherever and pick up their kids. They can stay at home, they can finish watching their TV programs, knowing that they're on a safe, reliable system that's going to get them home. Even though if they want to stay out later, they can stay out till 10:30. There won't be any of that, oh, I missed the last bus, can you come again?
Alright. Where do you stand on the home buyer's plan that allows first-time home buyers to use their RRSPs for a down payment? Would you support increasing the program limits? As it stands right now, I believe you can take out a maximum of $25,000 if you're a first-time home buyer. Same will begin with James on this one.
Honestly, I don't have anything from our platform on that. The opinion that I give would be my own opinion. Seeing the rising cost of housing in the area, young families who want to start off and want to buy their first home, offsetting taking more money out of their RRSPs for a down payment on a home, provided that they'll have the funding later on to replace that, so they haven't depleted their RRSPs for the future for their retirement, I think it would be a good idea. A $300,000 home taking out a 40-year mortgage, they can put a substantial down payment on their home. They can reduce it from a 40-year mortgage to a 25-year mortgage, the same thing that I'm sure many of us remember having. I can't fathom a 40-year mortgage. You buy your house when you're 20, and when you retire, you're free. It's not a plan that works anymore. Allowing them to use more money that they have, that they've saved, I think it would be a benefit to them, provided that they know that they're going to have to put it back in after a certain period of time, and they're able to.
Thank you, James. Tim?
The Liberal Party of Canada believes that every Canadian has a right to safe, adequate, and affordable housing. That supports the we support the indexation of the RRSP homebuyers plan to the consumer price index to facilitate Canada's realizing the dream of owning their own home. We're going to modernize the existing homebuyers plan so it helps more Canadians finance the purchase of a home, and we're also going to allow Canadians impacted by sudden and significant life changes such as job relocation, the death of a spouse, or marital breakdown, the decision to accommodate an elderly family member, to access this program and use money from their RRSP to buy a house without tax penalty.
Thank you, Tim. Harold?
Certainly anything we can do to help young Canadians especially achieve that dream of owning their own home is something that's worthwhile. So absolutely I'm in favor of increasing the limit from $25,000 to $35,000. This is something that I have raised virtually every year in our pre-budget consultations with our finance minister, and I'm thrilled to see it in this particular platform coming up. So our government is committed to the $35,000 removal of funds from their RRSP, provided, and this is part of the stipulation, the only way you can take it out is that it needs to be repaid within 15 years. You can't just leave it indefinitely, because as I pointed out earlier, we want to be sure that we're not jeopardizing future retirement needs. In addition to the $35,000 maximum withdrawal from RSP to homeownership, we've also have a $5,000 tax credit, which has been implemented to help first-time home buyers with the legal and all of the costs that go along with buying that home that aren't actually hard costs. So there's a $5,000 tax credit to help with the cost associated with purchasing a home, land transfer taxes, and so on. And in addition to that, one of the things that I am very proud of that our government has done is implementing, first of all, the tax-free savings account, and then recently increasing that limit to $10,000. Because there are a number of people who are able to put a little money aside, but if they're taxed on that money until the point where they can actually buy the house, that's an increased burden. So the tax-free savings account and also the limit, increasing the limit to $35,000 is a good move for our new prospective new homeowners.
Thank you, Harold. Final word to Bob on that question.
The Green Party has the idea for a national housing strategy, which doesn't currently exist, largely targeted at people who are not able to afford housing today, people who are probably considered marginalized. So the national housing strategy is consistent with making housing available to people. There was some talk that I heard recently where the Canadian Housing and Mortgage Corporation was planned on being privatized. The Green Party is certainly not in favor of that market, to keep that as a public entity. And another investment program by foreign investors called the Immigrant Investor Venture Capital Pilot Program, which is apparently turning housing over to foreign investors, making it completely unaffordable for Canadians. And the Green Party is very much opposed to that particular program and would remove it. But as far as making additional funds available to housing, I believe that that's entirely consistent with the Green Party's national strategy.
Right, thank you, Bob. Local development charges and other municipal fees and levies are taxes imposed by municipalities on new housing, onto which the GST is then applied to the sale price of a house. The question is, would you support eliminating the GST charged on municipal taxes? Tim?
You know, I'm going to pull the, this is my first time running, so I'm not a politician, I don't have that carefully crafted answer, so I'm going to say I am not sure, I would have to look at it.
You know, it's interesting, and you know, this question is so specific.
You had trouble asking.
No, but it's interesting, it's interesting that you say that, because I forget which candidate it was during yesterday's forum, basically said the same thing, just wasn't familiar
I'd rather not answer the detail
of that particular question. Nonetheless, Harold.
Yeah, I'm not a politician either, so I can't. No, in all seriousness, I have not given that much thought. I would want to look at it and see what the implications are to the Treasury, see what actual cost savings there would be passed on to the homeowner, and I certainly want to look at it. But at this point, I don't have a definite answer.
I assume that none of you are members of the Home Builders Association, right? Bob?
Sounds to me like it's double or even triple taxation. You're using income that's already been taxed to pay for a local development charge, which is a municipal tax, on top of which you get the GST. Double and triple taxation is not consistent with any Green Party policy that I know of, so I think that should certainly be under consideration. I can't say that that's an actual policy statement, but it's not consistent with existing Green Party policies.
James?
I would have to follow along with Tim and Harold on that one. You'd have to go through and look at it, see what the cost, see what the effect is going to be. What the savings would be for the home buyer. I don't have anything that I can find in my book on that.
Okay. What are your economic development priorities for Waterloo Region? Mr. Albrecht, let's start.
Well, again, in terms of the region and economic development, certainly some of the transit and infrastructure funding would be important. But beyond that, it goes to the heart of our government's desire to increase opportunities for local businesses. For local businesses itself, certainly there's an increased job market. So when it comes to trade agreements, I would continue to be active in trying to finalize trade agreements, but more importantly than that, it's fine to sign a trade agreement, but unless local manufacturers or local people who want to sell things offshore have the resources to actually use those trade agreements. So the trade offices, the trade council offices that we have in many parts of the world, we've increased the number so that when a tradesperson here wants to sell something to another country, they have help in finding what are the regulations there, what are some of the cultural things they need to be aware of. And that's some of the investments we've made in the Business Development Corporation, Export Development Canada, and the Canada Commercial Corporation. These are all things that are important resources for business to take advantage of export opportunities. So those things will indirectly impact the development here in the region.
Bob?
Somebody once told me that all politics is local. By the sound of the question, it certainly is. Green Party has national strategies, national strategies for housing, national strategies for sustainable jobs. All of those programs would apply to local people. I mean, it has to be implemented by the local citizens, the people of Waterloo Region, the people of Kitchener-Conestoga. Transit, obviously, public transit is a major investment area that the Green Party would look at first, as well as affordable housing.
Thank you, Bob. James?
I think a large part of being able to develop the area and strengthen the economy is our plan for $15 a day child care. The cost of child care is breaking household budgets. The average Canadian family is paying $1,000 per month. The program is proven in Quebec, where for every dollar invested in affordable, quality child care, there's a $2 return to the economy. With respect to this, it gives the parents the opportunity to take the time and find a job that they want to do, They can go out, they can participate in the income for the family. They can go out and they can buy those dresses that they want because the money's going to be there for them. $15 a day, affordable daycare. Also helps, earlier in the conversation, there was a timid mention about, with respect to immigration, mom coming over, dad coming over, child coming over, grandma coming over to take care of child. We don't need that. We can offer $15 a day affordable child care so that grandma can enjoy her day too without having to take care of granddad, our grandbaby, all day long while the two parents go out to work.
Thank you, James. Tim?
Well, we already touched on such things as infrastructure and affordable housing and environmental protection, but it doesn't get more local than when I just knock on door after door after door and people talk about the cost of living and how they're struggling to get by, and we're turning into a nation of haves and have-nots. It's that ever-shrinking middle class. And so that's a local issue, but that's a local issue across Canada, if that makes sense. And so when we tell them about reducing taxes for the middle class, and then I explain how it's costing, how the Liberal plan is actually costing, we're going to raise taxes on the wealthiest 1% of Canadians, I get thanked at the door. And then I tell about the Canada Child Benefit Plan, which unlike the conservative UCCB checks for families, which is taxable income, we have to give about 40% of that back come tax time. The Liberals are proposing a Canada Child Benefit Plan, which is simple, it's tax-free, it's rolling up a number of complicated programs into one simple tax-free family benefit that's going to benefit 9 out of 10 families. We're talking about tax relief for the middle class, and that locally is what people want to hear over and over again, giving them a chance.
Harold?
Well, I don't think the question was on child care, but since we're into that, I should address the fact that the proposal of our NDP colleagues for a $15 a day child care plan leaves far too many families out. There are far too many rural families, far too many families who are not working 9-to-5 jobs that would not benefit at all from that NDP plan. Our plan puts the money into the hands of the parents, $160 per month for each child under 6, $60 per month for each child from 6 to 18. In addition to that, it allows the parents, if one of them is earning a higher income than the other, or perhaps one isn't earning an income at all, it allows those parents to share that income. So if a person earning $150,000 and one person earning zero, they can take 50 of that, put it into the lower income earner's salary, and that reduces their overall tax burden. This is a huge saving to young families. As a father of 3 children and 9 grandchildren, I am committed to investing in the lives of young families, because it's young families that are the future of this country. And unless we allow them to succeed and reduce the tax burden that my colleagues refer to, they're going to have a tougher and tougher time.
Our plan, you just finished saying that there's so many people that are left out using our plan.
Correct.
You just finished saying that you're giving them money to stay home. They don't want to stay home. You ask them. They want to go out there. They want to contribute to society. They want to go out there and they want to earn their own keep. They don't want to have to ask whether they can spend some money on something, because dad is the only one that's working and they can't afford to pay for the child care the way it is now. I mean, you're the same way. You want to pay them to stay home. We want to give them the opportunity to go out there and work, to contribute to their own family income. That's what it's all about.
I certainly wasn't implying that we wouldn't give parents the choice whether to work or not. But I do take exception with the implication that if you're staying at home, you're not being productive. I had the benefit of a mother who cared for me and was home. I had the benefit of my children being raised in that environment. It's not for everyone. I'm not implying for a second that it is. But if a parent chooses that, they shouldn't be penalized. That's all we're saying. Give them the choice.
Sure, I'm in a situation where my wife is staying home with our children and very proud to be doing that, and she's doing what she wants, I'm doing what I want. So we would actually be in that small 15% of people who are benefiting from income splitting. And let me just digress and say the Liberals will not cancel pension income splitting for seniors. I'll say that again over and over again because there's some misinformation out there. You got that part. So we are in that 15%, not the 85% that income splitting doesn't help, but we're in the 15% that it does help. We would be willing to give that up. That makes no sense on a level. And also, the conservative plan, those child benefit checks that they're sending out are the same across the board. So millionaires are getting the same checks as average hard-working Canadians that are not doing well. The Liberal plan is income tested. The size that you get for child check for the child benefit goes by your income. And so at a certain point, at $200,000, you're no longer getting that check. And millionaires should not be getting the same child benefits, actually. Just don't need them.
All right, Harold. I'm just going to
go back to Harold's comment. It seemed to be putting words into my mouth. The statement was that it gives them the opportunity to contribute. I never said that they weren't contributing by staying at home. I understand my mother stayed at home and raised me, as well as my other seven brothers and sisters. My wife stayed home and she raised our three kids. I have six grandkids as well. My kids, they want to go out and they want to be able to work. $15 a day care will give them that opportunity. And that's all it was. There is no meaning in there that they're not contributing to society by staying at home.
Thank you, Harold.
Except you did say that it would give them an opportunity to contribute. So you could imply that. However, we'll leave that as it is. Back to the point of taxation and the millionaires getting the same benefit that someone in a lower income. That problem, if you want to call it a problem, is dealt with by the fact, which we're criticized for, is that it is taxable. So it stands to reason that the person who is in a higher tax bracket would not keep as much of the child care benefit that they're receiving. That stands to reason. But it does help those who aren't in that tax bracket to achieve their goals.
Bob?
Good example of giving with one hand and taking away with the other. Income splitting is an excellent tool if you have sufficient income to split. It's one of these inequitable things that is truly beneficial to the people who have the income to split, who can then take advantage of tax breaks that aren't available to the people who don't have that income to split. I have to give some kudos to the Liberal parties. Back, I don't know, 35 years ago, there was an experiment that they did with something called MinCom, where people were guaranteed a livable income, which is actually a Green Party platform. And it was proven in that experiment, which just took place in Manitoba and Saskatchewan, that even though people were given sufficient income to live on by the government, they ended up becoming more productive citizens. They now had no worries about where their food would come from, where the next rent check advantage by staying in school longer. So students no longer have to drop out of school to look for work because they had this guaranteed minimum income where they could stay in school. Mothers were able to stay not seek work immediately after having children. So there was maternal benefits there that came out of that. And people who were out of work were able to search for work that was more fitting to them. So rather than having somebody with a skilled trade like a sheet metal worker having to go flip burgers because they needed emergency sustainable employment, they were able to look for work that they had been trained for, and so become, in the long run, far more productive citizens to their community. So as far as people not benefiting from handouts or people riding on government coffers and taking advantage of that, that doesn't happen. Canadians are better than that.
Tim touched on the income splitting aspect of things. For working families, the NDP will not allow it to remain. It costs the government far too much. Seniors, it will not be touched for the retirees. The seniors will be entitled to maintain.
All right. Final categories, healthcare and social services. The Greater KW Chamber has for about 20 years led local community efforts to attract more family doctors to our region. The healthcare portfolio, therefore, has been a long-standing priority of the Chamber in both provincial and federal submissions. First question, will your party increase healthcare funding to the provinces through the Canada Health Transfer. Bob, to you.
There is a plan to address the health corps so that there will be more equitable distribution of health care funds. The biggest thing that the Green Party has proposed is a national pharmacare plan. You've got national medical benefits, but people still have to pay for their own pharmaceuticals, which in most industrialized countries is not the case. People have to make a decision whether or not they need to buy their pain medicine or whether they need to be putting food on the table. That shouldn't be happening in Canada.
Thank you, Bob. Jamie?
Tom and the NDP, they brought forward long-term stable funding, worked with the provinces and territories to ensure more Canadians can access a family doctor and primary care teams. We're going to invest $300 million to help build 200 clinics across Canada, help the provinces hire over 7,000 doctors, nurses, and practitioners, nurses and other healthcare professionals. We're going to maximize access to the health services by targeting communities and neighborhoods that are facing doctor shortages. The problems with the wait times and access to health services started under the Liberals and Stephen Harper. He has done no better. Our priority is to make needed investments in healthcare and balance the budget by asking Canada's large corporations to pay their fair share. We haven't heard anything from the Liberals on that. Just a story to follow up with that. My sister, if you were here provincially, you would have heard the story. My sister had health issues. She lived on the outskirts of London. The closest hospital was St. Thomas. Investment in small clinics and small communities such as this one, Linwood, Floridale, things like that. Small clinics staffed by quality physicians and nurses. My sister died on the way to the hospital. The reason why was there was no clinic nearby. She had to try and get 45 minutes from her home in her car with her husband driving, begging her to hang on, that they were almost there. To me, this isn't the Canada that does that kind of things to their people. They deserve health care. It should be where they are. They shouldn't have to go to it for 45 minutes.
Thank you, James. Tim?
Well, the cost of prescription drugs, like Bob mentioned, is becoming increasingly expensive. And it's becoming inaccessible to Canadians, and that is absolutely right. All Canadians should have access to affordable prescription drugs, regardless of where they live across the country and their personal financial situation. This is a while ago, but back in 2004, the Health Accord signed with the provinces and territories by a previous Liberal government. We actually created a national pharmaceutical strategy, which was going to reduce the cost of prescription drugs. The plan was killed in 2006 by the Harper Conservatives, and government has done nothing in the last 6 years to move this forward. So we've already committed to talk to the provinces on other topics, and we'll absolutely commit to talk to the premiers about how to strengthen health care by making measurable progress on issues like wait time, affordability, prescription drugs, and certainly the availability of home care.
Thank you, Tim. Finally, to Harold.
Well, thanks for the question. It's a little difficult for me to respond after that last response when I remember the $25 billion in cuts in 1995 and 6. The previous government actually slashed healthcare funding and social transfers in order to balance the budget. We have not had to do that. We have increased federal funding for healthcare by 6% every year since we took office. We are currently spending 69% more on healthcare than we took office, in spite of the fact that you continue to hear that we've made cuts. We've committed to increasing healthcare funding over the next number of years by 3% per year, or the cost of inflation, whichever is higher. So if inflation is at 1.5%, healthcare transfers go up by 3%. That is not a cut. We continue to believe in the healthcare system that Canada has. It's one of the best in the world. Many in this room could attest to that. It isn't perfect, but I will do everything I can to be sure that healthcare transfers continue to increase. Our government has already committed to it. So yes, we will continue to invest in healthcare. The one thing that we also are implementing and working hard on is the area of research for healthcare. It's not only important that we continue to invest in delivering healthcare as you and I might know it, but it's important that we do research to increase our efficiency and to increase our effectiveness. So we're investing millions of dollars in cancer research, cardiovascular and stroke research, mental health research,
and brain health research as it relates to Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease. Many of these initiatives are helpful in reducing costs down the road, and these are factors that we can take into consideration as well.
With what scientists do plan on doing this research? I understand that many scientists are no longer the employee of the federal government.
We're going to move on to the next question under the health category, and you touched on it earlier. You can be as brief as you want. We have a couple social services questions to get to. Very simply, does your party support a national pharmacare program? If so, when would you expect this program to be implemented? James, we'll start with you. I'll repeat the question. Does your party support a national pharmacare program? If so, when would you expect this program to be implemented?
I know that we do have a plan to reduce the cost of prescriptions to Canadians. Bulk purchasing is where it will start. Also, as the patents come down on the expensive cancer drugs, the generics will move in at a much faster rate and be available to those who need it.
All right.
Yeah. We've already said we're going to commit to work with the provinces to lower the drug costs. Our platform, there's still some pieces left, and that, stay tuned for that.
All right, Harold?
Yeah, at this point, I'm not aware of any commitment to fund a pharmacare program. Quite frankly, for me personally, I would far rather see our government commit to a cross-Canada palliative care program, which I think is probably in more desperate need than the pharmacare program. However, I'm open to discussing that and studying it further with my colleagues, but at this point, I'm not aware of any commitment to implement a pharmacare program as such.
I think you're all from the bottom.
Yes, absolutely. National pharmacare program. Funded to the tune of $300 million a year, starting immediately upon election.
Right. Next question. 2 years ago, the Canadian Chamber of Commerce, at their annual general meeting, along with the Greater KW Chamber, presented and passed a resolution calling on the federal government to address the chronic homeless problem in Canada, the issue of homelessness in this country. The question is, will your party increase funding for affordable housing and implement a long-term plan that requires all levels of government working together to address this issue? Tim, we'll start with you.
Well, this is, fits in exactly with that Liberal plan for infrastructure. The third of that big $60 billion investment into infrastructure was for social infrastructure. So that absolutely. So we're talking about $20 billion over 10 years for affordable homes and seniors' homes. And that's a sustainable, reliable source, because right now, promising people money and then taking it away, promising a little or back-ending it, just gives people less hope. And so as far as affordable housing, we're going to, like I said, a massive infrastructure investment into that. And I believe, that's enough said.
Thank you, Harold.
Well, certainly sustainable housing is an important issue for all levels of government, and I'm proud to have worked along with some of the local partners here as it relates to providing affordable housing. Mental Homes is a good example. Show Waterloo, Supportable Housing of Waterloo, another example where they partner with the municipality, they partner with the region and the province and the federal government to create affordable housing units. In 2015, our budget implemented a $2.3 billion per year over the next 4 years, on top of the $253 million that we make available for these local projects that I just outlined. For me, one of the things that I'm most proud of, however, in terms of affordable housing, is the Housing First program that our government implemented as it relates to mental health. We all know that those suffering from mental health challenges face immense challenges in many areas. But we found through research through the Mental Health Commission of Canada that if you provide that housing first, give them a place to live, a safe place to go home to, that many of the problems that accompany mental health challenges are mitigated. So I'm very proud of that record, and our government has recently announced that they're continuing to support that Housing First program. And in fact, they're asking partners such as Mental Homes and others to make sure that up to 65% of their funds go to that priority of providing housing first to those who are facing mental health challenges. And that's one thing I'm proud of.
And yet the Conservative government has not implemented a national housing policy. Certainly at the top of the list of the Green Party things to do. I see by my notes here that there is an increasing amount of funding to be delivered nationally for a national affordable housing program, starting at $400 million a year, increasing every year to almost $1.4 billion after 5 years. Included with that is food and water first. There are many communities in northern Ontario even where there is no fresh water available. So there's a plan within the Green Party platform to have a fresh water, safe drinking water, and improved housing plan for all Canadians.
All right, thank you, Bob. And final one to James.
Yeah, we have a concrete plan to make sure that more Canadians have a safe, comfortable, and affordable home. Larger cities, Vancouver, Toronto, families are being priced out of the market. 3.2 million Canadians, one in nine, live with housing needs. This means that they spend more than they can afford on housing, or they live in homes needing major repairs or are overcrowded. On any given night, there are 35,000 Canadians that are homeless. Families do deserve better. Over the past 25 years of Liberal and Conservative governments, Canada's national investment in housing has fallen over 46%. Cuts in downloading by the last Liberal government made Canada the only OECD country without a housing strategy. Remaining federal investments in housing since the 1990s have been time-limited and putting housing at risk each time the agreement expires and making long-term planning impossible. Now, the result, the wait for an affordable unit can stretch up to 9 years, and the Conservatives opposed NDP's Affordable Housing Act, and Justin Trudeau didn't show up for that vote. An NDP government will enact the Affordable Housing Act, Bill C-400, an act to ensure secure, adequate, accessible, and affordable housing for Canadians. The bill will recognize housing as a right and lead to the development of a national housing strategy. We'll partner with municipalities, provinces, and First Nation communities to restore long-term, stable investing in affordable housing. We'll make sure that housing is more affordable in our communities by sustaining investment in Canada's affordable housing agreements, by providing incentives for the construction of 10,000 affordable and market rental housing units, and will renew cooperative housing operating agreements that are set to expire and invest over $2 billion in cooperative and social housing by 2020.
All right, final question of the forum. Does your party propose any major reforms to the employment insurance system? Does your party propose any major reforms to the EI system? If so, when will they be implemented? Mr. Albrecht, let's start with you.
The employment insurance premiums, $1.88 per thousand, have been frozen since 2013. For small businesses, those who have a payroll of, or premiums of less than $15,000, that EI premium was lowered to $1.60. However, we are proposing that from 2017 on, that $1.88 rate for $1,000 will drop to $1.49. That's a 21% decrease. This recognizes the immense cost of our payroll taxes to our employers. I used to be an employer of five people, and that's not a very large group of employees, but I know how much the CPP and EI payroll taxes added to the cost of doing business. So when you can multiply that by 10 or 20 times for large, small businesses, it's certainly a huge increase. So we are definitely trying to do all that we can to keep the EI premiums in line. And one of the big changes that we've made in the past number of years is to make the EI premium a separate account. Many of you will remember that during the Liberal administration, $52 billion of EI premiums were used for general revenue. That is unacceptable. Our government is committed that there will be a separate board administering that, and the rates will be set according to the needs of the EI fund at that point. But at this point, committing to $1.88 drop to $1.49 by 2017.
Thank you, Harold. Bob.
Out of all the good plans for employment insurance, there are fewer and fewer people who are able to take advantage of employment insurance. Certainly, if you have to wait 6 weeks before you are eligible for employment insurance benefits, your rent has come due at the end of 4 weeks, and what are you to do? The Green Party plans to implement a guaranteed livable income, and that will go a long way towards tiding you over without actually affecting the employment insurance benefits. So, while not directly addressing the insurance the employment insurance benefits program directly. There are many other assistance plans in the Green Party platform that will help people who have find themselves out of work.
Thank you, Bob. James?
We do have a plan for EI. It should be there when you need it. Tom and the NDP will protect EI funds and make sure that the rules are fair. Over 200,000 more Canadians are jobless now than before the 2008 recession, a total of 1.3 million unemployed, not counting those who have just simply given up on trying to find a job. The quality of the new jobs also is at a 25-year low, with more part-time hours, lower wages, fewer benefits, and finding a good job can take weeks or even months. Yet fewer and fewer unemployed Canadians are qualifying for benefits. In 1990, 83% of the unemployed received benefits. That dropped to 42% in 1998 and 36% last year. Again, when Liberal Prime Minister Paul Martin overhauled EI, used to be called unemployment insurance, 4 out of 10 unemployed Canadians lost their benefits. And now, under Stephen Harper's Conservatives, the number of people qualifying for EI has hit an all-time low. Instead of addressing the real issues, the economy, the Conservatives have attacked unemployed Canadians, bringing in new rules that force them to take a 30% pay cut or risk losing their benefits. Together, the Liberals and Conservative governments have raided the EI. He missed the part of them taking money out of the EI as well, $57 billion to pay for unrelated programs and corporate tax giveaways. Justin has a new proposal to use EI premiums Canadians have paid to companies for tax breaks, and it's a poorly thought of plan. Economists say it won't work to create jobs. Tom will care, and our NDP team will reverse Harper's changes to the work that forces workers to take a 30% pay cut or risk losing their benefits. Essentially, with that, with respect to that, they're forced to take a job. Even though I'm a tradesperson and I have a ticket, if I become unemployed and they say, no, there's a job open over there, and not to diss any companies or anything like that, but go be a greeter over there. That job is open, you're gonna take it, we want you off the system. That's where that's headed. Will they end the practice of governments raiding the EI fund to cover expenses that they can't cover from the regular funding? By taking immediate steps to fix the Social Security Tribunal, reduce wait times for EI appeals, and when EI works, more Canadians can find suitable, quality jobs sooner, and it's good for families, and it is good for our economy. And being in the construction trades, I can tell you that my brothers and sisters out there, when they are unemployed, for them to wait, and Bob is right, for them to have to wait anywhere from 6 to 8 weeks before they can get a check, and they're paid, in their pocket. By that time, another job has come along that they've taken, and they don't even get any of the benefits. Not even sent out, okay? Just put it back in their pocket. And it's not right. They work for it, they pay for it, it should be available. It should be available for them when they need it.
James, thank you. Final word out to Tim. And Harold, what's going to go? Tim?
You know, in these difficult times, a reliable employment insurance system is vital to get Canadians back on their feet again. Unfortunately, over the past 10 years, Stephen Harper's Conservatives have cut the EI benefits, and far, we've heard all the stories, far few Canadians are qualifying for these benefits that they very much need. And at the same time, the Conservatives have reduced service levels at Service Canada for EI claims, leading to extreme serious delays in processing times, which you can see James just mentioned. So the Liberals understand that we need an employment insurance system that reflects the changing labor market. So, firstly, we're going to reduce EI premiums from $1.88 to $1.65, which reduces payroll costs for employers and employees. We're going to reduce waiting periods for the EI benefits down to 1 week. And we're going to end the higher 910-hour eligibility penalty for new workers and those re-entering the workforce, which stops the discrimination that makes it harder for parents to return to the workforce, younger workers, or people who have left due to illness. We're going to also increase skills training. We want to get people back working through a $500 million annual increase in funding to the labor market development agreements that we're going to work out with the provinces. So we've got very concrete results.
All right, thank you very much, Tim and Harold.
Just a quick question to my NDP colleague. Is he implying
that the average Canadian would rather sit at home on employment insurance than take a productive job that may pay 30% less than the one he left. If he's implying that, I think that's an indicator of why we're in some of the difficulties we are in some of the areas of this country. To have productive work, even though it may not pay as much as you had before, is certainly, in my opinion, better than sitting on home collecting employment insurance.
The implication there was that they are being forced off of the system instead of being able to remain on the system to find a job in their field. The issue is, when they get told, there's a job opening over there, I know that you're not going to be making $20 an hour, 30%, you're going to be making $12 an hour. Sorry, you have to take it. Well, these people, they've set their budgets, their household budgets, just like the government does for Canada, that they have to follow. They know what they need for an income. And if they're being, if their income that they're getting with EI is enough to support them, while they're looking for a job in their field, I think it's more important than being forced out into the workforce and being told that you're cut off of the system.
What I mentioned before, the Dauphin-Manitoba income experiment has proven that people who are getting a guaranteed livable income do not just sit around collecting benefits. They will go out and find productive work. They will go out and find productive work in their field, which may take a little bit longer, but that's what those benefits are there for. It's to be able to provide people with that assistance so that they can find work in their field. And as the experiment proved, that is actually what Canadians do. They don't just sit around collecting benefits because they can.
I'll leave it right there. Anybody else wants to? All right, thank you. And it's time for the closing remarks. And again, we're going to just keep going in order, the rotation. And so we're looking at a 60-second maximum for your closing remarks. And we will begin with Bob. Go ahead, Bob.
One thing that I found in talking to people is that they find that the current government is no longer representing them. That's what I first joined the Green Party for, to work on a system that would actually be representative to everybody, but the current government is not doing it for the bulk of Canadian citizens. Many people that I speak to say, oh, you're with the Green Party, I really like what you're standing for. And so I figure, excellent, this is a supporter. And then they say, but I don't believe you have a chance of winning because you don't get enough votes. Well, the reason that the Green Party doesn't get enough votes is because not enough people are voting for the Green Party, even though they believe that those principles that the Green Party stands for are sound. Strategic voting doesn't work. There was a strong strategic program, two strategic programs in the last election, neither of which made any difference in the outcome of the election at all. My suggestion is that if you feel that the Green Party is actually supporting your principles, that the programs that the Green Party is proposing best represent you, then that's what you should do. You should vote for the candidate that best represents you. I hope that's a Green Party member, but vote regardless and vote for the representative to represent you.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you. James?
Thank you, Glenn. Hopefully everyone will be talking to their friends and neighbors who couldn't make it to this debate tonight. There is plenty of discussion regarding this election. This election is about change. Many just want the Conservatives gone, but find themselves on the fence. I can assure you, Tom Mulcair has the experience to fix the damage done by Harper's Conservatives. If you find yourself on the fence this election, take the stop home with you. Liberals held 36 seats at the call of this election. NDP held 95. In order for Liberals to defeat Harper, they will need to win 134 more seats and keep the 36 that they have. Tom Mulcair and his NDP only need 75 seats to defeat Harper. Serving my members for 16 years, I'm ready to embrace a larger group and still be able to meet their needs. After October 19th, I look forward to being your voice in Ottawa. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you. Tim.
Thank you for the seat count and challenge accepted. So, this election is a clear choice between smart investments that create job and growth or austerity and cuts that's going to slow our economy further. The Liberal Party is committed to investing in our future. We've got a real plan, We're focused on growing the middle class, getting more money to help families raise their children, restoring transparency in government, and fighting climate change. After a decade of Stephen Harper, Canadians' faith in government has never been lower. After promising reform, the Conservatives have delivered the most centralized, self-serving government in Canadian history. A government that muzzles scientists, dismisses veterans, ignores our Native and Aboriginal population, and disregards the environment. Voters have a clear choice on Election Day, and I believe the Conservatives have had their chance. It's time for the Liberal Party, and it's time for real change now.
Thanks again to the Chamber of Commerce for hosting this event, and thanks, Glenn, for moderating this debate, and thanks to each of you for participating today. Friends, Canada has weathered the economic crisis better than any G7 partner. By working with our provincial and municipal colleagues, we've invested in crucial infrastructure improvements. We've invested record amounts in health care and social services. We've seen the creation of 1.2 million net new jobs. We have a plan to create an additional 1.3 million new jobs by 2020. Working with small business as the engine of our economy, we can stay on the road to prosperity for Canada. We can't afford more debt. We can't afford higher taxes. On October 19, I need your help to keep Canada on track with proven leadership in a fragile world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill. On behalf of the Chamber and 570 News, I want to thank all the candidates. I'll put a hand for all the candidates. Thank you very much. Have a great one.